Almost 2 million kids were born in 1991 in the USSR. That was the last generation born in the Soviet Union. The USSR occupied 1/6 of all Earth's land and consisted of 15 republics. At the time of its collapse, it was ranked second in the world in terms of industrial production. It was home to almost 300 million people of more than 200 different nationalities. The education system was ranked fourth in the world. The army of the USSR was the largest and most powerful in the world, with allies including most Eastern European countries, East Germany, Vietnam, and Cuba. Was life good for ordinary people? Why did it collapse? Let's take a deep dive into this mysterious union of 15 republics that existed for 69 years. The Soviet Union was formed in 1922, after 5 years of civil war. Like most revolutions, it was fueled by the appallingly low standard of living in the Russian Empire, the exploitation of workers and peasants, and the oppression of certain nationalities, all while the nobility and bourgeoisie enjoyed enormous wealth and luxurious palaces. In October 1917, ordinary people, under the leadership of the Bolshevik Party, overthrew the government. This was the start of the famous October Revolution. The old nobility, the whites, immediately struck back, starting a civil war against the Bolsheviks, the Reds. Former Tsarist officers faced off against the Red Army, made up mostly of peasants. Civil war raged throughout the country for almost 5 years and ended with the victory of the Red Army. The young state was left in ruins. The 1920s saw the formation of a young Soviet state, from idea to reality. The territories of Poland, Finland, Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania, Western Belarus, Western Ukraine, and Bessarabia left the former Russian Empire. The Soviet Union barely had 135 million inhabitants. During the Civil War, mines and industry had been destroyed. With no fuel available, the few remaining factories were shut down. Left with no jobs, qualified specialists emigrated en masse. This time bomb would explode decades later, when the Soviet Union found itself lacking scientists, engineers, managers, and qualified leaders. Historians and analysts would later acknowledge this huge missed opportunity. At first, Western states did not recognize the USSR. Partly, they feared a red plague and sensed the threat of worldwide revolution. Western states mostly preferred to pressure the USSR to pay Tsarist Russia's massive debts. As a result, the new Soviet state was left to fend for itself, without any governing help or guidance from the outside world. It's not surprising that famine broke out every now and then, famine caused by gross miscalculation and naive mismanagement. For example, the government introduced special flour taxes without taking into account potential harvest failure and absence of crop reserves. On the political front, a one-party system was established. The all-Russian Bolshevik Communist Party held every seat. The Council of People's Commissars, like a Western cabinet, formally ruled the state. But real power resided in the Central Committee of the Bolshevik Party. It consisted of the most influential October Revolution leaders, Lenin's Guard. The Central Committee had the power to assign important governmental positions. Only members of the Bolshevik Party could be assigned. That's why so many people were keen on becoming official party members. It was the only way to have a steady career. With all its initial setbacks, the USSR still found a way to restore their country. In 1921, the Soviets created their state bank, and later, they replaced their old, depreciated money for a new Soviet currency. In Central Asia, new Union republics were born: Tajik, Uzbek, and Turkmen. The goal was to give accelerated education to representatives of the indigenous people and attract them to the administrative apparatus to form the local intelligentsia. The education system was changed, private schools were abolished, and free education became law. Corporal punishment was abolished, and schools and governments were released from the influence of regional religions. As a result, these regions became industrial agrarian republics with high educational and cultural growth. National culture and local language was preserved and spoken alongside Russian. Local language textbooks were written for the first time ever. Children, both boys and girls, could finally study together in their mother tongue. Fundamental changes also took place in public life. Women had equal rights to men, such as the right to vote. The divorce process was simplified and could be carried out by either spouse, by mail. These policies helped restore the national economy and were crucial to the USSR's successful diplomatic acceptance by the rest of the world. After the end of World War II, the USSR became a superpower, along with the United States. Land Army combat experience, along with the latest weapons, gave the USSR one of the strongest militaries in the world. In 1949, the USSR became the second country in the world with nuclear weapons. And in 1954, it built the world's first nuclear power plant. At the same time, fearing the growing power of the USSR, the US, Canada, and Europe created NATO and began active anti-communist propaganda. Back home in the Soviet Union, repression and censorship grew. The targets were senior officers, party workers, artists, and scientists. Stalin, the leader of the Bolshevik Party, was afraid of losing power as he noticed increasing respect for Soviet military marshals. This paranoia spurred on even more repression and censorship. Anyone voicing any opinion was branded a traitor to the USSR and a Western sympathizer. Stalin's era of terror saw millions of Soviets illegally imprisoned, murdered, or even worse, left to die in their own homes.